أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبا القاسم محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. أما بعد, respected scholars, elders, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Insha'Allah has a continuation from the previous night in which we started to talk about the Holy Quran and the true manifestations of the Holy Quran, and in which we discussed that we can't have the Quran by itself without people to translate it for us, as in the Quran is perfect in itself. However, we also need perfect beings that have knowledge of this perfection to give us the complete and entire message. Now, in saying that, inshallah, tonight we want to look at in a more further perspective. First and foremost, inshallah, for tonight, we want to look at, as a completing instance from yesterday, other aspects in history and other aspects of modern day society that we can take as an example. Because yesterday we took examples from history in previous years and the years in which our imams up until the 11th imam lived. And we took examples of how religion and how Quran has been misinterpreted. But let's look at it on a 21st century. Inshallah, that's what we want to start off tonight. How in the 21st century there is misinterpretations in the Quran, and how vast are these misinterpretations? And inshallah, from then we want to move on to how we can take into our lives, as discussed yesterday, how we can take the manifestations of the Holy Quran, the people that actually understand and have the knowledge and the depth in the Quran, and apply it to our lives. I want to look at a very simple example, very detailed, very simple, but it's very profound, because we may look into ourselves and we can be one of the people that I'll be mentioning, inshallah, tonight. So pay close attention within the limited time that we have for tonight. And tomorrow, inshallah, will be the concluding night that I have been blessed to be on this pulpit, inshallah, serving the Ahlul Bayt. So please help me in starting tonight's topic by reciting aloud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Yesterday we discussed how the Khulafa of old take into perspective particular verses from the Holy Quran, and how in many occasions they could not derive the correct meanings from the Holy Quran. Now, in that being said, someone came forth and may ask that how is it that someone may come and say that this may apply in the 21st century. We have so much sciences nowadays. We have so much knowledge nowadays. We have so much advances nowadays. 1400 years ago, maybe the Khulafa didn't have these advancements. Maybe they didn't have this knowledge. I want to give you an example of one particular person, and in an aspect that you might think to yourself or overlook, that it's such an obvious thing. But people nowadays, in other schools of thought, they call themselves Muslim, in other schools of thought, taking the perspective, we all unanimously, whether it be in a scientific level or a religious level, we all come to a conclusion that the earth is round. Do we not? Can anyone here say that the earth is not round? No one comes forth and says the earth's not round. Now, in history, people have said amongst many timelines that the earth was originally flat, but now it comes to our attention. And throughout history, it became clearer and clearer as the advancement happened that the earth is actually round, that the earth is not the center of the universe. However, till nowadays, a person that died only a couple of years ago, I honestly don't want to even mention his name because his pulpit is sacred in itself. So I don't want to mention his name from the pulpit. But everyone knows him very well. He says, anyone that doesn't believe, he says, whoever doesn't believe the earth is flat is a kafir. Excuse me, he says, yes, anyone that doesn't believe the earth is flat is a kafir. Like, how do you come to that conclusion? He says, the Quran. And this person, nowadays, even after that person passed away, إلى جهنم وبئس المصير. The person nowadays, he says, our great scholars, our great scholars believed that the earth was flat and still is. And anyone says otherwise, we shouldn't even take their perspective and they're an infidel. That's what happens when you don't have the correct translation of the Quran. That's what you have when people come forth and deliver and think whatever they think about the Quran. This person, look at, because they say, don't attack us without knowledge. We have our knowledge. Let's look at their knowledge. Look at what they say. How they try to back up their arguments from the Quran. One of the backing they said, it says, we believe the earth is flat. Why? He says, well, you can imagine, we fly, and he was in Saudi Arabia. He says, if we fly from here, go towards China. He says, if the earth is flat, it's easy. We can go up, we can land in China. He says, but everyone says that the earth is rotating. He says, if we go towards China and the earth is rotating, we'll never reach China. And you think to yourself, how on earth did these people come into a particular position of power? How did they even, like you tell a child nowadays, five-year-old child, you tell them this particular perspective and they say, no, well, obviously this makes more sense. What else? What else? It says in the Holy Quran, it says that if Allah wants to bring down His punishment from the seventh sky, it will fall on the Kaaba. And this is the dalil from the Quran. This is how we have the Quran as being misinterpreted by these people. It says Allah says in the Quran, if the punishment will fall, it will fall on the Kaaba. What was this person's argument? He says if the earth wasn't flat and it's rotating, if the punishment falls, it will fall in the sea or fall somewhere else within the mainland. It won't fall on the Kaaba. This is the actual argument that they bring forth. This is what happens when people don't know how to translate the Holy Quran. This is what happens when people don't hold on to the true manifestation of the Quran, which are Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. The problem is they have such certainty. Such certainty. What did we say in the first nights in Ramadan? The only difference, and one of the main differences between the school of Ahlul Bayt and the Khariji schools of thought. The schools of thought that say, don't question anything. Whereas the school of Islam, the school of Ahlul Bayt, the Ja'fari school of thought, what does it say? It says, make sure you know that knowledge that you gain, where it's coming from. Make sure you know that knowledge. Who said that particular line? That quote, where is it originating it from? Isn't it originating from the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt? Is this manifestation of knowledge coming from the Ahlul Bayt or is it coming from their enemies?